All right, the recording has begun. If you guys have any questions, you can share them now. If you don't have questions, then I can make this a special teaching just on whatever comes to my mind, which I think you guys would find interesting. So I'll play it by ear, seeing what you guys want to do. Do you have certain questions on your mind, or are you not pretty much nothing really on your mind right now? What about, is it Lee? All I see is Lee 45. Is that your first name, Lee? Do you have any questions, or are you, same with David, nothing on your mind at the moment? All right. So, as I said in previous presentations, it's the way I wanted to do this is not so much having a script, but just kind of letting it freely go wherever it ends up going, based on, you know, what people ask or what people say, and then what I say. You know, just I want it to be free like that, and I find that would be make it a lot more interesting. So let me think for a second what would be good to start with today. Let's see here. Well, one of the things I touched upon in the most recent one where we left off with are major differences in the biblical text. Not the extra books, mind you, but the regular books of the Bible. So it would probably be a very good idea to look into some of those differences. If you guys are interested in that, I can go through some of those differences, because there are some amazing, like, what people don't realize, but when you compare them very in depth, you see the striking, like, wow, like, this was there the whole time, I just didn't realize it, because there's so much out there, it's just people don't have a lot of time to see these things. I guess a good place to start would be First Samuel. I'm going to start with First Samuel, I think. Now, hold on a second while I open. I'm going to open the file where of the version that I did of First Samuel, and then I'm going to basically indicate to you guys. I'm going to point you guys to the main differences. We can't go through all the differences because there's just so many major differences, but I'm going to go through the ones that I feel are the most interesting. So just one second. Let's see here. I'm loading the PDF file. I just have to bring it up. Sorry I didn't have it in advance, because I wasn't planning what to do, so so you'll find some of the information I'm going to be presenting tonight is going to be very, if you didn't know the information I'm going to present, it's going to be very eye-opening seeing how many differences there are in scripture. Let's see here. There we go. Okay, I forgot the guy's name that I was trying to find where I had sent him the PDF file. I just, for some reason, I had a mind blank. I couldn't remember the guy's name. But I found it, so. Alright. Now, if you guys can, I would appreciate it if you could follow along. If you have a copy of the Bible, either online or in person, you can follow along with the English translation. A good one to use would be the New King James or the King James, but any translation will pretty much work because pretty much all the translations are from the Masoretic text. So they have all the main basic readings that the Hebrew text that the rabbis have preserved for us. They have basically the same preservation. So I'm going to see. Now, just so you guys know, I mean, I don't refer to 1st and 2nd Samuel as the 1st and 2nd Samuel. Obviously, that's the name that scholars gave it afterwards. I refer to it as the Chronicles of David, because in the Bible, it actually tells us that there, for the rest of certain information about David, you can find it in the Chronicles of David. That's what, I think it's either 1st and 2nd Kings, or I think it's 1st and 2nd Chronicles, which one of those two tells us that there's information of David's chronicles. And what do we see in 1st and 2nd Samuel? That book focuses almost entirely on David, the reign of David. You know, or what led up to his reign, that is, and then the main events of his reign. So I call it the Chronicles of David. And let's see here. Okay, so chapter one is where we'll start, and I'm going to read now. This is verses 5 to 6 of 1 Samuel chapter one. I'm going to read first from the King James Version, okay? Or maybe I'll do King James. Do you guys think I should read from the King James or the New King James? The New King James is a little bit updated language. King James, okay. So here is verses 5 to 6 from the King James. It reads, "But unto Hanah he gave a worthy portion, for he loved Hanah. But the Lord had shut up her womb, and her adversary also provoked her sore, for to make her fret, because the Lord had shut up her womb." Now the Septuagint of that same passage reads, and to Anna he gave a prime portion because she had no child. Only Elkanah loved Anna more than the other, but the Lord had closed her womb. For the Lord gave her no child in her affliction, and according to the despondency of her affliction, and she was dispirited on this account, that the Lord shut up her womb so as not to give her a child. You can see of that, if you were following along, that the Septuagint has like an entire extra sentence in there. So let me go through it again. Let's see here. The Masoretic text, the King James, all it says is that he gave Hanah a worthy portion because he loved her. But in the Septuagint, it says, because she had no child. That's a major difference right there. And then the all this says in the King James, it says he loved Hanah. The Septuagint says Elkanah loved Anna more than the other. More than the other. So it's things like that where those are some major details not in the King James Version. And you're going to see these details all throughout the Septuagint. Huge extra details which are not in the Masoretic text. So what is up with that? That's very crazy, because if these words are scripture, we're missing so many words in the Hebrew text. And in the Dead Sea Scroll copy, the Dead Sea Scroll copy agrees with the Septuagint more often than not. It has these extra words. And then the Dead Sea Scroll copy has even more words that the Septuagint version doesn't have. So it's amazing that, and this is not just for 1 Samuel, but this is for so many of the books of the Bible, where we're seeing this, that the Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls have extra passages which are just, they add extra details which are significant. And you know how people cling on every little detail of scripture. Well, these people are in for a rude awakening, because if you're going by every little detail, then if you're missing details, then that's a major obstacle. That's a major issue. The Hebrew text says that Yahuwah, the Lord, had shut up her womb, and her adversary also provoked her sore for to make her fret. Whereas the Septuagint translates it differently, and it has it has more words. So it says, "For the Lord gave her no child in her affliction, and according to the despondency of her affliction, and she was dispirited on this account, that the Lord shut up her womb so as to not give her a child." That's just so much extra detail, and it's actually contrary to what the Hebrew text says. The Hebrew text, or at least the way the King James translates it, it says that her adversary, it's implied that the co-wife of Elkanah, the other woman, was her adversary. But that's not what it says in the Septuagint. It says in the Septuagint that it says, the Lord gave her no child in her affliction, so not adversary, her affliction, she was afflicted, and then according to the despondency of her affliction, and she was dispirited on this account. So right there, it's not talking about someone being her adversary. It's talking about herself causing herself affliction because she was depressed that she did not have a child. So these are some major differences we're already seeing, and we're only in the first chapter. So, it's like, what other major differences are there? Hold on, someone's asking how to join. So, 1 second as I tell her. Okay, so hopefully we're getting another person to come in now. So, but I see a question. Are there different versions of the Septuagint? Can I download just any Septuagint on the internet? There's the standard Septuagint, which is very good, and that's the one I used. And that is the English translation that Brenton used. That Brenton did. Now, just so you know, the Septuagint, there's thousands of manuscripts of the Septuagint, and they differ in many ways. But the main unique things that define the Septuagint are in all the manuscripts, or at least in the majority of the manuscripts. And so I would say you are to, for the Septuagint, you want to basically get the Brentons, and maybe get a couple other translations, but they're all going to basically, for the most part, read the same, with the exception of a couple books, but otherwise they're going to essentially read the same in almost every passage. So I would recommend getting Brentons, English translation of Brentons. That's the starting one to start by. All right, so can you you ask about Essene Matthew? I'm not sure which one you're referring to. Can you clarify which book of Matthew that you're speaking of? Are you talking about the Gospel of Matthew and a special Hebrew version, or are you talking about something else? And Melissa, now that you've joined in, basically I started teaching about some of the differences in 1 Samuel. Now, if you have questions related on something else, on a completely different topic, feel free to ask those questions. And if you want, you can ask them now. But so far, what I was doing was going through the beginning of 1 Samuel and showing some major differences. So David, yeah, you downloaded Brenton's version. Yep, that's the one. That's the one I was referring to. So Melissa, if you can type in your questions there, that would be great. While you're typing in the next question, I'm going to go to the next interesting difference. Verse 8 of 1 Samuel. It reads in the King James Version, "Then said Elkanah, her husband, to her, Hanah, why weepest thou, and why eatest thou not, and why is thy heart grieved? Am I not better to thee than 10 sons?" The Septuagint says, "And Elkanah, her husband, said to her, Hanah. And she said to him, Here am I, my lord. And he said to her, What ails thee, that thou weepest? And why dost thou not eat? And why does thy heart smite thee? Am I not better to thee than 10 children?" So you see right there that the Septuagint has an extra little dialogue back and forth, where in the King James it just says, "Hanah, why weepest thou?" In the Septuagint it says, "Hanah, and she said to him, Here am I, my lord. And he said to her, What ails thee that thou weepest?" So there's a whole extra thing. Now, it seems clear to me that the scribes were looking and seeing this little dialogue there is not really necessary. Let's just remove it, because we don't need to know that, like, really that's not that big of a importance to the passage, at least that in their kind of thinking. So it's things like that all throughout the Bible. In every book, you'll find things like that. In the Septuagint and in the Dead Sea Scrolls, gives much extra detail, more dialogue. In the Hebrew text, is fragmented, stuff's removed. The Masoretic text, that is, it's horrible. So the Gospel of Matthew. The question was asked. There's Hebrew Gospel of Matthew. I'm not sure about an Essene Gospel of Matthew. The Hebrew Gospels of Matthew, I think, there are some authentic readings in them, and that they are important for textual criticism, but I don't think that they are the perfect representation of the original text. I'm still open to more research on that, because the New Testament is, I find it's more complicated, the New Testament, the differences, because there's not as many major differences in the New Testament. There are tons of differences, but they're minor differences compared to the Old Testament differences in manuscripts. So I have a harder time determining sometimes in the New Testament which readings were the original. If what I said didn't sufficiently answer the question of the Essene Matthew, maybe you could clarify a little bit more, like what you know about it yourself, and then I could give a better answer. But that's what I would say. So Melissa asks, is it true a fragment of Mark, the Gospel of Mark that is, was found at Qumran? In other words, was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And she also says, and the same also for Timothy, the letter that Paul wrote to Timothy. Basically, there are some scholars who say that the New Testament was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and which would be very significant if that was the case. I wish that would be the case, and I used to believe it, but I didn't have absolute proof. I just kind of wanted it to be true, and then as I was kind of doing more research, I was realizing that it seems to me that the Dead Sea Scroll writings precede the time of the Messiah. They were written before he came. And it doesn't seem to reflect Yeshua's teachings. In other words, Yeshua's teachings agrees with the Dead Sea Scrolls, but the way Yeshua teaches it is more developed than what the Dead Sea Scrolls say. They're a different style in many ways. And I feel like the New Testament is more developed, and we don't see all the developments of the New Testament in the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Dead Sea Scrolls is a simpler, more archaic version of Yeshua's teachings, the Messiah's teachings. And when you actually look at the evidence, the fragments that they are telling us are fragments of the New Testament, it's very dubious at best. Basically, the fragments that they're saying have like one or two letters on them, maybe sometimes three or four letters, but that's really not enough letters to clinch an identification of a document. It really is not. Most of the time, you know, sometimes if there's enough letters, even if there's only like five letters, that could be enough to clinch it. But for the most part, it's not enough. And so I would say it's possible that there was fragments of the New Testament in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but it seems highly unlikely based on insufficient material and material evidence and the there are differences. There are differences, like when you take the Greek text and when you take like the standard Greek text of the New Testament and then you compare it to what the Greek text supposedly is of the New Testament in the Dead Sea Scrolls, there are too many differences. So you'd have to basically say that in order for there to be New Testament copies in the Dead Sea Scrolls, there have to be major differences in the letters, the Greek letters used, how they've spelled things, word placements, missing words that are not found in any other manuscript of the New Testament. So what it seems like it, this is what it seems like has happened, is that those who believe the New Testament was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls want it to be true so bad that they kind of read into the scrolls the idea. So that the problem is when you change what the scrolls say, like, let me think of an example. Okay, in the Greek text of the Dead Sea Scrolls, it has the letter Dalet, which is a D, equivalent to a D. In the New Testament, same passage, it has a tav or a tau instead of a dalet. So, and there's so many things like that, where in order for the Dead Sea Scroll text to be a copy of the New Testament, it would have to be altered letters, which are not indicated in any other copies of the New Testament that we have. And the problem is if you can make it so that no matter what the text says, you can fit it to something, that's a problem because it's falsifiability. You don't have the falsifiability. Any letter that's there, you'll just simply say, oh, that must be a different way of of spelling that word or something. You can force it to fit with all these unnatural contortions. But the best way to deal with these texts is not to try to force it to fit, but just see what it says, and if it's not adding up, it's probably not the same document. It's probably some other document. And another issue is, were Paul's letters originally written in Greek? It's possible they were. But if they weren't, that means that they would have had to be translated immediately into Greek, and then there were to be a copy in the scrolls. And that's highly unlikely that it would wind up like that. And Paul's letters were being circulated as living documents, so they probably wouldn't have been stored in pots in the ground, because they weren't ancient writings. So they didn't treasure them as ancient writings. It doesn't seem to me that they would have done that. So, and Paul's letters were circulated everywhere. So it seems unlikely that they would feel the need to preserve his letters in a special way. It seems more likely that they would preserve the more ancient, the more holy writings that there were much fewer copies of. Hopefully that answers that question. Now, if you have other questions, please share. But I'm going to go to another reading in the King James Version versus the Septuagint of the 1 Samuel. We see in chapter 1, verse 11, it says in King James, "And she vowed a vow and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid, and remember me, and not forget thine handmaid, but wilt give unto thine handmaid a man-child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head." The Septuagint says, "And she vowed a vow to the Lord, saying, O Lord God of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look upon the upon the humiliation of thine handmaid, and remember me, and not forget thine handmaid, and give to thine handmaid a man-child, then I will indeed dedicate him to thee till the day of his death, and he shall drink no wine nor strong drink, and no razor shall come upon his head." So there's some differences there. So the Hebrew text just says, "And she vowed a vow and said," but it doesn't say to who she said, whereas the Septuagint says, "She vowed a vow to the Lord, to Yahuwah." So right there, that's extra details. And then we are told, the Masoretic says, "Then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life." It says in the Septuagint, "I will indeed dedicate him to thee, not to the Lord, but to thee." And then we also see it says in the Hebrew text, "all the days of his life, and there shall no razor come upon his head." The Septuagint says, "till the day of his death, and he shall drink no wine nor strong drink, and no razor shall come upon his head." So the extra detail of no wine, no strong drink, that fits with the Nazarite, but it's not in the Masoretic text. It's in the Septuagint. So the Masoretic text has removed that important detail. So that's a difference right there. Let's see here. Here's another interesting one. Verse 14 says, in the King James, "And Eli said unto her, How long wilt thou be drunken? Put away thy wine from thee." The Septuagint says, "And the servant of Eli said to her, How long wilt thou be drunken? Take away thy wine from thee, and go out from the presence of the Lord." That extra little line at the end, "go out from the presence of the Lord," is not in the Hebrew text that as we have it. And the Hebrew text the King James is translated from says, "Eli said unto her," and yet the Septuagint says, "the servant of Eli said unto her." What's up with that? Did the Septuagint writers decide to add a servant into it? Unlikely. Rather, it seems that it was the servant who was the one who said it. And then later they said, well, you know, the servant is talking on behalf of Eli, so you could basically say that Eli was talking to her. So let's just say Eli, let's just remove servant of. So that's the difference right there. Let's see here. Let me find another interesting one. It's still in the first chapter, and I guess we'll do I'm gonna read verses I'm gonna read 21. I'm gonna just read 21 all the way to 28. And I'm going to go through the differences, okay? Because there are some major differences in these verses. So, King James says, "And the man Elkanah and all his house went up to offer unto the Lord the yearly sacrifice and his vow. But Hannah went not up, for she said unto her husband, I will not go up until the child be weaned, and then I will bring him, that he may appear before the Lord, and there abide forever. And Elkanah, her husband, said unto her, Do what seemeth thee good, tarry until thou have weaned him. Only the Lord establish his word. So the woman abode, and gave her son suck until she weaned him. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, with three bullocks in one ephah of flour, and a bottle of wine, and brought him unto the house of the Lord in Shiloh, and the child was young. And they slew a bullock, and brought the child to Eli. And she said, O my Lord, as thy soul liveth, my Lord, I am the woman that stood by thee here, praying unto the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord hath given me my petition, which I asked of him. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord, and he worshipped the Lord there." So, so it starts off the same in verse 21 in the Septuagint, but there's a difference. In it says in the Hebrew text that Elkanah and all his house went up to offer unto the Lord the yearly sacrifice. In the Septuagint, it says, went up to offer unto the Lord in Shiloh. So the detail in Shiloh is in the Septuagint. The yearly sacrifice and the Hebrew text says, the yearly sacrifice and his vow. The Septuagint says, the yearly sacrifice and his vows, and all the tithes of his land. The tithes of his land is not mentioned in the Hebrew text. That's a detail that's just being removed because the scribes thought, oh, whatever, we don't need that detail. And then it says that The Hebrew text of the King James Version says, Hannah went not up. But the Septuagint says, but Hannah did not go up with him. Did not go up with him. and then let's see here. Not, the King James says, "I will not go up until the child be weaned." The Septuagint says, "I will not go up until the child goes up when I have weaned him." So there's a little bit extra detail there. And then, this is found in the Dead Sea Scrolls and in no other copies. It's not in the Septuagint. At the end of verse 22, at the end of that verse, so we see in the King James it says, "And there abide forever." In the Septuagint it says, "And he shall abide there continually." The Dead Sea Scrolls, however, continues and says, "And I will dedicate him as a Nazarite forever, all the days of his life." So that extra sentence is in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but in no other copy. And then we have, let's see here. One second. I have to load up the Septuagint. Okay, so there's another question, I think. So I'm going to answer that question, but just one second while I look this up. Let's see here. I'm opening up the Septuagint because I was using my own version. Let's see here. Okay, it's 23. Okay, so the King James Version says in verse 23, only the Lord establish his word. Only the Lord establish his word. The Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, "But may the Lord establish that which comes out of thy mouth." So that's a huge difference right there. Okay, so before I continue with the rest of the differences, I'll answer this question right here. And this is totally fine. I'm fine with you guys asking these questions. Even if it's not about the topic that we're discussing, feel free to ask anything, because I appreciate all the questions, no matter what it is on the topic. Lee asks, "Do you think the 24 priests in Chronicles, which are the same names in the Dead Sea Scrolls in the priestly order, are they, it seems like you're saying, are they the 24 elders in Revelation?" I'm not quite sure. There's several different possibilities of the 24 elders of Revelation. There's, in the Old Testament, there were actually 24 prophets of Israel. The Gospel of Thomas tells us, hold on. The Gospel of Thomas says, I have to load it. Sorry. But this is an interesting reading. So it says, "His disciples said to him, 24 prophets have spoken in Israel, and they all spoke of you. He said to them, 'You have disregarded the living one who is in your presence and have spoken of the dead.'" What does he mean by that? What he means is, not that the prophets are bad, that we shouldn't read this, we shouldn't consult the prophets, but basically he's saying, why are you focusing on these prophets who are dead when I'm a prophet and I'm right in front of you? Don't focus so much on them, but you won't always have me, so focus on me. That's kind of like what he was saying about the poor people. Remember when they said, how could you have used this ointment? It was so expensive, it could have fed so many poor people. And then he basically said, you will not always have you will always have poor people with you, but you will not always have me. Basically, I'm important, very important. I'm a prophet. I'm the Messiah, essentially. I'm the Son of God. I'm here right now. But you're so blinded that you're not listening to what I'm saying. You're trying to you're focusing on reading the Bible, which is fine to read it, so long as you're not ignoring what I'm saying. And that's what they were kind of ignoring. They were ignoring what he was saying and talking about the 24 prophets. He said, listen to me. Come to me that you may have life, basically. Not the scriptures. The Bible can't save you. Only I can save you. That's what the Messiah was saying. But so the 24 prophets, and the lives of the prophets tells us that there were 24 prophets. I don't know who the 24 elders are. I can't say for certain, but there's different possibilities. So I don't think they're the 24 books of the Old Testament, though. And so it could be the 24 priests. Oh, actually, I'm pretty sure there was 26 priests. I don't think there was 24 priests. If I remember correctly, I think there was 26. But maybe there was 24. So I have to double check that. Because now that I'm thinking, maybe there was 24. Okay. For some reason, I remember 26 for something. I don't know if I'm misremembering or confusing that with something else. So, let's see here. And then another question. Was the Messiah taught by the Yahad? Yeah, and then the names of the priests are the same as the names in the Dead Sea Scrolls. The names for the priests of the Dead Sea Scrolls. The priestly order is the same as First Chronicles. Was the Messiah? This other question was Messiah taught by the Yahad or by the Dead Sea Scroll people, the Essenes? And, you know, basically we are told that from the time of 12 years old to 30 years old, we're not told what happened in that time period. There must have been some things happening in that time period. I don't think he was just sitting there twiddling his thumbs. He was probably learning, studying, but he was staying in behind the scenes. It seems to me that while he was behind the scenes, he was being taught by the Essenes. Little play on words there. I think it seems most likely to me that, you know, as he's studying, he was studying the scriptures. And who had all these extra scriptures that he accepted? The Essene writers. So he was studying Enoch, he was studying Jubilees, he was studying all these other scriptures, because that's how he said, you don't know the scriptures. If you knew the scriptures, you'd know that they testify of me. They wrote about me. Well, how did he know they wrote about him? Well, he studied the scriptures. He knew the scriptures. So I do think that he was taught by them. But he also, as a new prophet, he was becoming a leader of the Essenes, and he was actually teaching them things, and some of the Essenes probably didn't agree with some of his teachings. Because we have to be honest and think, it's very unlikely that all the Essenes were faithful to the truth, and that all the Essenes were open to a new prophet. I'm sure there were some who did not like these new teachings that he was giving. But I would say the most of the Essenes saw that his teachings were in line with what they were looking for. But so I do think they taught him, but they were also taught by him. As the Apocrypha tells us, he was teaching them when he was just a child. He was teaching them wisdom. Or not the Essenes, but he was teaching other people wisdom already, just as a child. And that's what the New Testament says in Luke, that he was, when he was 12 years old, with. Does it say he was teaching? I can't remember if he taught in Luke or not. Sometimes I get the books confused, but the scriptures do teach that he was teaching as a young child. So I think it goes both ways. He was taught by them, but he was also teaching. So if you have other questions, let me know. But I'm going to go back to the passage that I was going through. Here's another difference. It says in verse 24, in the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Septuagint, In the King James, it says, she took him up with her with three bullocks and one ephah of flour. The Dead Sea Scrolls and the Septuagint says, she went up with him to Shiloh. To Shiloh is not in the Hebrew, the Masoretic. And then instead of three calves, which the Masoretic says, the Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, with a calf of 3 years of age. So, three-year-old calf. Let's see here. And the Septuagint and Dead Sea Scrolls also tell us that she brought loaves up, bread. The Masoretic does not tell us that. So that's a striking difference. Three calves is what we're told in the regular Bibles. The Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, no, not three animals. It was one animal that was 3 years old. That's a major difference right there. And then I'm going to read now. I'm going to read the very end of verse 24 and then 25 from the King James. It says, and the child was young, and they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. That's the King James. That same passage in the Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, and the child with them, and they brought him before the Lord, and his father slew his offering, which he offered from year to year to the Lord, and he brought near the child and slew the calf, and Hannah, the mother of the child, brought him to Eli. That is crazy difference. Okay, the King James, as I said, says the child. At the end of 24 says, and the child was young. The Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, and the child with them. And it has a whole extra thing of, and they brought him before the Lord, and his father slew his offering, which he offered from year to year to the Lord, and he brought near the child. The King James just says, and they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. And the Septuagint Masoretic says, and slew the calf, and Hannah, the mother of the child, brought him to Eli. So the words Hannah, the mother of the child, are extra words in the Septuagint, not in the Masoretic text. So you see already, wow, it's some major differences that the Septuagint details and the Dead Sea Scrolls is giving us details that the Hebrew text, which pretty much all Messianics are using, is so horribly corrupt and pathetic. What's up with that? And I'm going to say the final thing. Verse 28, let's see here. Okay. S- So the it says in the Masoretic, the King James, it says, therefore also, this is the verse 28 of chapter 1, therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. The Dead Sea Scrolls says to us, and I lent him to the Lord all his days, all his days that he lives, alone to the Lord. So she left him there, and she worshiped the Lord there. So the words, so she left him there, and she, are not in the Hebrew text that we have, of the Masoretic, but it's in the scroll. So the Masoretic is telling us that it was he, her son, who worshiped the Lord there, but the Dead Sea Scrolls says it was she, the mother, who worshiped the Lord there. And there's the extra detail that the scrolls say that she left him there. So already, that's just one chapter of 1 Samuel. You can imagine what else in the book of Samuel was altered, and what else in all the other books was altered. There's just so much. It's insane. And it's really depressing if you don't have faith and you're not truly seeking him. Once you find this information out, it's very easy to fall away from the Bible because people don't know how to take it, because it goes against what they were always taught, that the Bible is perfectly preserved or that it's very reliably preserved, when it really it's not. The copies we have are mangled. They're mangled copies that the scribes took the original text and they were removing words that they thought were not needed, unnecessary words they thought, making it easier for their scribal, try writing 10 pages of text and then try writing 3 pages of text. Which one takes longer? The 10 pages takes longer. If you can do 3 pages and cover the same basic information, a scribe is going to want to do that and be lazy. That's just how the way men are. That's how humans are, how they think. They become lazy with these jobs. And Jeremiah, the book of Jeremiah, tells us that the scribes corrupted the scriptures, corrupted the law with the false pen of the scribes. So, let's see here. I'd be interested to know a little bit more what you're talking about. I'm not quite sure what you mentioned about the Enoch calendar. You're saying when you add the priestly order to the Enoch calendar, the Hebrew meanings are prophetic and tells a story to the days of the calendar. I haven't done that, but that very well may be true. I'd be interested to hear more about that idea. Because there are so many hidden meanings and prophecies in the scriptures, especially with the language. It's amazing what's being hidden due to bad translations. But when you look and dive into the Hebrew, it really brings life into the scriptures in a way that is unimaginable. There's so many secrets that I bet once I start studying Hebrew even more than I already have been, it's going to open so many things and there's going to be so many explanations and revelations just by reevaluating the Hebrew text as we have it, and really learning the Hebrew language and seeing how it applies. Okay, I'll have to check that YouTube thing that you're saying. And I didn't look at the Exodus passage right here about the east wind and the south wind, where you're saying the differences. But yeah, there are things like that in many places. And Exodus is one of the books that is altered in many the copies. There's some major differences where the Septuagint, the Samaritan, and the Dead Sea Scrolls, all three of them have major extra words, extra details, which are not in the regular Hebrew text that most Bibles are being based on in the Hebrew Roots movement. So, we'll have to go through, in the future, we'll have to go through these documents. Like, there's so much to go through. So many amazing things to show you guys. So let's see here. Are you guys okay with me going a little bit more through some of the First Samuel of the differences? Or is that uninteresting to you guys? I don't want to... I find it interesting, but, you know, I want to make sure that you guys are being enjoying what's being presented. Because if you are, then I can go through a little bit more of some of the difference, some of the interesting differences in First Samuel. Because there are some pretty cool ones. Let's see here. All right. Again, there's a lot of differences, but I'm just gonna try to only do the most important ones. So I'm gonna skip some of them, but okay, near the end of I'll just start with the so it's in chapter 2 of 1 Samuel, and it is verse 8, and I'm going to read verse 8 to verse 10, okay? Verse 8 to verse 10. King James Version. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust, and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes, and to make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them. He will keep the feet of his saints, and the wicked shall be silent in darkness, for by strength shall no man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Out of heaven shall he thunder upon them. The Lord shall judge the ends of the earth, and he shall give strength unto his king, and exalt the horn of his anointed. The Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, it's verse 8 is the same in all of them, essentially. So, hold on 1 second. So the King James says, and to make them inherit the throne of glory. The Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says, causing them to inherit the throne of glory. Now it starts, granting his petition to him that prays, and he blesses the years of the righteous, for by strength cannot man prevail. The Lord will weaken his adversary. The Lord is holy. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom, nor let the mighty man boast in his strength, and let not the rich man boast in his wealth, but let him that boasts boast in this, to understand and know the Lord, and to execute judgment and justice in the midst of the earth. The Lord has gone up to the heavens and has thundered. The Lord will judge the extremities of the earth, and he gives strength to our kings and will exalt the horn of his anointed. Let me just double check to make sure I did that right. Yeah, so did you see that extra thing there? That's crazy. All right, so let me just highlight what the difference is there, because it's not always easy to see when someone's reading to you both versions, but when it's pointed out to you, it's like, wow. So it says in the King James, and to make them inherit the throne of glory, for the pillars of the earth are the Lord's. Hold on. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them. One second. I'm trying to make sense of the differences. Let's see here. Hold on one second. Yeah, so, I mean, so you see that. It says, it says, in verse 10, it says, the King James, the adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. The Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls says the Lord will weaken his adversary. So that's basically the same thing. But then from right there on to the rest, okay, so the adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Out of heaven shall he thunder upon them. That's the Masoretic text. The Septuagint says, in that same those same words, it says, the Lord will weaken his adversary. The Lord is holy. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom, nor let the mighty man boast in his strength, and let not the rich man boast in his wealth. But let him that boasts boast in this, to understand and know the Lord, and to execute judgment and justice in the midst of the earth. The Lord has gone up to the heavens and has thundered. So you see, like, that's like a small little bit in the Masoretic, and then the Septuagint is like a huge thing about the rich and boasting and stuff like that. Like, you know, it's striking that kind of difference. Let's see. Okay, here's one. Verse 16. I'm going to read verse 16 of the chapter, chapter 2. In the King James Version, it says, and if any man said unto him, let them not fail to burn the fat presently, and then take as much as thy soul desireth, then he would answer him, nay, but thou shalt give it me now. And if not, I will take it by force. That's the King James, okay? The Dead Sea Scrolls, which is partially confirmed by... wait, let me double check that. I was going to say it's confirmed by the... Actually, yeah, it's not confirmed by the Septuagint. So this is the Dead Sea Scrolls, extra thing in the Dead Sea Scrolls. That same passage says... And if the man answered and said to the priest's servant, first let the priest burn the fat as it is fit, and take for thyself of all things which thy soul desires, then he would say, nay, for thou shalt give it me now. Or if not, I will take the ram by force to give him the meat. And taking a flesh hook of three teeth in his hand, he struck it into the great cauldron, or into the pot, and took whatever came up with the flesh hook. If the man that sacrificed said to burn the fat as his only fit, he took it by force, and this was done daily. So you see, the regular text simply tells us, a regular text that we have in our Bibles simply tells us that, like, it gives less details, and the Dead Sea Scrolls is more repetitive. It gives the extra details and repeats the details. Okay, here's a question. It's not about the First Samuel, but this is another question, which is a very good one. According to Ezekiel 40-48, this was asked by Lee, they are offering up animal sacrifices in the millennium. And the question is, why? Well, I'll say two things about that. First, I do believe it is correct and accurate to apply the prophecies of Ezekiel in those chapters to the millennium, but the primary meaning in the original of it was more of a command and not as a prophecy. It was more of, this is what you are to do. You must do this. The command was, the priests are to do to build the temple according to the vision that Ezekiel saw. Similarly, the Israelites were given a command to build the New Jerusalem according to the specifications that Ezekiel saw in his vision. So, yes, it is referring to the millennium, but not so much as a prophecy, but more as, this is a command. You're being commanded to do this. Unfortunately, we know that the command is not going to be fulfilled until the millennium. But the command was given, and it was fully intended. When Ezekiel was telling them, he wanted them to build it as soon as possible. If you read Ezekiel, he's telling the people and saying, build, you know, these are the laws for you, Israel, to learn these laws and what is clean and unclean, and follow these laws. That's why some Christians will say that that's what was supposed to be done, but then when the Messiah came, now we don't have the Ezekiel thing that was commanded, Ezekiel 40-48, that was God's will at the time, but it never happened and is no longer necessary. Well, that's kind of silly to me. Why would he write 8 chapters which were never done in history? That doesn't make sense. It's clear that this is going to happen, it will happen, and is needed to happen. But the question is, why are the animal sacrifices in the millennium? There's other passages in the Bible which say the same thing, that there will be sacrifices of animals in the millennium. And the reason for this is the same reason when you look, there were animal sacrifices before the flood. Abel did an animal sacrifice. So it shows that there was already, even though you weren't allowed to eat animals before the flood, that's what Genesis says, animals only became to be eaten after the flood by humans, being okay to do that. And the same thing with animals. The animals were not supposed to be eating each other. They started doing that because of sin, because of the Nephilim corrupting them. But then they, after the flood, things were changed by God so that the diets were adjusted to reflect their natures that they chose for themselves. And so, but we see, even though there was not, no one was allowed to eat meat, and yet they were killing animals for sacrifice. Abel was doing that. So why is that? You know, why was there animal sacrifices? What's the purpose of animal sacrifices? Well, something important is that sin offering is not correct. There was never a sin offering but commanded by God. This is false translation. I'm strongly believing that. I do not believe the sin offering was ever done. The Jews misinterpreted it and were doing it as a sin offering, but it was never intended as a sin offering. It was intended as a purification. And how we know this is because in the New Testament we're told animals cannot be offered for sins, cannot atone for sins. And yet the Old Testament says animals can atone as a sin offering. Contradiction there. And then we're told that in the law, when a woman gives birth to a male a child or a daughter, you need to give a sin offering. Is it a sin to give birth to a child? Or is the child sinful by nature? Does he have a sin nature that you have to atone for? That's what some people would argue, but according to the New Testament, Mary and Joseph offered animal sacrifices for the Messiah as a sin offering. It doesn't say sin offering, but it's the same offering that the law of Moses says, the sin offering for the child that's born. They did that in obedience to the law. They gave a sin offering for the birth of the Messiah. And yet we're told the Messiah never sinned, and we know that the Messiah does not have a sin nature. So it's clear that childbirth is not a sin. It's not a sin to give birth to a child. So why does it say it's a sin offering? Because that's a false translation. Really, it's that word means missing the mark. The scholars will tell us it means missing the mark. And it does not always mean sinful missing the mark. It can sometimes mean sinful missing the mark, because sin is missing the mark of righteousness, of perfection. But it can also be missing the mark of something that's not sinful at all. It's just having bad aim. According to the book of Judges, there were some archers who could, or, you know, warriors or people of the army who could sling a stone at a piece of hair and not sin. The word is sin, but they don't translate it as sin. You'll see in the Bible, they usually translate it as miss. They're so good, they can sling a stone at a hair and not miss. But that word is sin, but they're translating it as miss. It's the same Hebrew word for sin. But really what it's saying is they could sling a stone and not miss the mark. Of what? Of sin? No, miss the mark of the hair, of accuracy. And we're told by David in the Psalms, when he's asking God to forgive him of his sins, they translate it as purify me, God. Why do they translate sin, the word Hebrew word sin, why do they translate that as purify or cleanse? David is asking him to purify him of his sin, but yet he says the word that usually is translated as sin. So it wouldn't make sense for him to say, sin me from my sin. You know, rather he was saying, pass me over. You know, miss, you know, in your judgment, miss me. Don't hold me accounted to this. Don't target me with your wrath. Now that's basically what he's saying in the passage, and that's why they translate it as purify or cleanse me, because they know he's not meaning please sin against me. He's not meaning that. It uses the same Hebrew word, though. So we have to realize, when it says sin offering, why do we need to translate it as sin offering when we know that it can sometimes not have anything to do with sin at all, but it can be purification, cleansing. According to Hebrews, animals are effective and powerful for what? Hebrews tells us to purify for the sanctifying of the flesh. So animal sacrifices purify our bodies, our physical bodies, from impurities. They do not purify our souls from sin. Animal sacrifices don't purify our souls from sin, but they purify our bodies from impurities. That's what Hebrews says. Sanctifying for the purifying of the flesh. And so, why would animal sacrifices be done in the millennial kingdom after the Messiah has done his atoning work? It's because the Messiah's priesthood, his sacrifice, was for our eternal salvation, for our spiritual, our soul, our conscience, our morality. The animal sacrifices were never intended for that. So the Messiah did not replace the animals, because the animals were never being done for that purpose in the first place. The purpose for the animal sacrifices was to purify our bodies. Just like you might say, okay, now that the Messiah come, I don't have to purify my body anymore. The law tells us if you touch something unclean, if you sleep with a woman, you become unclean by the and the woman becomes unclean too. If you touch a menstruating woman, she's unclean, she makes you unclean. And if you touch a person that's a dead body, you have to clean yourself, purify yourself on the first day, the third day, and the seventh day. You have to wash yourself before sunset. Even though the Messiah came, we still have to do that. We still have to wash ourselves, because if we're not washing ourselves, we're being unclean. We're being impure. A good hygiene, good health requires washing when you're dirty, when you're unclean. And so the Messiah's work was for righteousness, for morality. It wasn't so that we could now no longer be becoming unclean, because uncleanness is just unhealthiness, or, you know, a impurity of the body. And as we can all know by looking at nature, even though the Messiah came, horrible things still happen the same way. People are getting raped still. They're getting murdered. Horrible diseases. All the uncleanness that was there is still here, and there's even more uncleanness than there ever has been in the past. So the Messiah's atoning work did not make it so that the laws of uncleanness are no longer required. the laws of uncleanness still are needed, because that's just the nature of the flesh. The flesh becomes impure when it comes in contact with certain impure substances, and unless the Messiah does a miracle to heal us of the uncleanness, we have to heal ourselves through the way nature tells us to do it, and the law gives us the way to do that. We purify our bodies through washing, but we also do it for animal sacrifices. The animal sacrifices, they're not so much a purifying of us physically. Like, I mean, as I said, it's purifying of our physical bodies, but it's more of a spiritual purification of our bodies. So it's like making our bodies holy again. Our bodies are, when our bodies are unclean, they're unholy. So to make our bodies holy again, we offer sacrifices. That's the purpose. So now that the sacrifices are being done, not being done right now, because the priesthood is being sinful and not obeying his commandments, they're not doing the priesthood, we ask, are we sinning because we're not doing the sacrifices, or are we unhealthy because we're not doing the sacrifices? I don't think we're unhealthy. I think we're unholy because we're not doing the sacrifices. There's an important difference. He says, be holy as I am holy. But we're also supposed to be clean, too. Cleanness and holiness is not the same thing. So the sacrifices don't make an unclean person clean. Rather, they make a unholy person holy. They fix the holiness that they lost. Okay, that's how I understand the sacrifices. So it's about holiness, about priesthood, sanctification of your body. It says in the law, the temple scroll, that when a priest is ordained as a priest, you have to ordain them as a priest. And how do you do that? Through a special ceremony where you do sacrifices, and the sacrifices sanctify that person to become a priest, the high priest, or a regular Levite priest. So, and then what about all the holy days? There are sacrifices for those holy days. It's to purify us so that we'll be holy to keep those holy days in the temple area, because we're commanded 3 times a year to go to the temple to keep the feasts in the temple area. So to be holy enough to do that, we do the sacrifices for that purpose. So the sacrifices is all about that. And then there's also sacrifices for worship, burnt offerings. It's okay to worship Yahuwah, and he commands us to do it in the way that the law says, worship him. But the question is, why animals? Why do we have to kill animals to do it? Because a lot of people have an issue with animals dying, and I understand that. I don't want animals to die either. And in fact, I believe if we kill animals for a vain purpose, we are basically murdering and being evil. But I don't believe all killing of animals is evil or murder. I think there is a place and purpose for killing animals, and the same thing with plants. I think they are living beings, but we can use them for a good purpose. And why do we need animals to make ourselves sanctified or holy? That's a good question. I would say the animals enable us. I don't want to make something up, so let me just think about it for a second. But basically, the animals kind of. It's like about the sacrifices, right? The sacrifices and a covering where I guess the way I would see it is that just like how God is, you know, like he's the chief and he deserves sacrifices. He doesn't benefit from the sacrifices, but, you know, it's a way of worshiping him. It brings it back to him in that sense. But it's also the sacrifices help make us holy because we have the image of God. We have his image. So it's a way of showing that we need that... that, you know, I didn't explain it well, what I just said, and I don't want to, as I said, I don't want to make something up, so I need to think more about why, basically, we see what the law tells us. The law tells us sacrifices are required, but it doesn't say why were they required, and I was just trying to give an explanation from my own ideas of why they are required. I told you what the scriptures say, that it is required for making us holy, to purify us of unholiness. But I didn't say why animal sacrifices are needed to make us holy. And that's what I was trying to answer. I'm not 100% certain I can give an answer on the spot right now of why animal sacrifices are needed to make us holy. But I trust God when he said that to us, that they are needed to make us whole. So in the future, I'm going to think more about that, and then I can try to give a fuller answer next time, if I can figure out for myself the reason why. Because there's many things that when God gives us commandments, he knows why, but we don't always know why. But as a faithful servant, we need to obey him. So long as we don't see anything evil about it, we need to obey it, even if we don't like it, even if we don't understand why he's telling us to do something, but we must do it because he is the king and he knows what's best. So, you know, there's so many things, like, you know, Abraham. Abraham was commanded to offer his son, right? Abraham was commanded to offer his firstborn son. Abraham probably didn't understand why, but he was faithful and he was going to do it because he knew that that's what God wanted and he was saying to do it, so he's going to do it because he's a faithful servant. So that's what we have to be too. Even if we don't understand the sacrifices of why they're needed, he's telling us they're going to be needed again for our holiness. So that's what we need to do. And Lee says that the soul of flesh is in the blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And, you know, someone could, as, you know, someone asking why, they would say, why is it the case that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin? Why? Why do we need shedding of blood for there to be remission of sin? And that's a good question. But the scriptures tell us that, so unless we can somehow prove that it's not the case, then we should believe what the scriptures say, even if we don't fully understand why shedding of blood is needed for remission of sin. But as I said a little bit earlier before, animal sacrifices do not atone or remove sin, but they remove the same word, that's the Hebrew word for sin, it's the same word, it's like missing the mark. There was no remission of impurity or wrongs or falsehood. Sometimes it's difficult how to translate that word, but it doesn't always mean sin. And animals, as I said, don't cover or remit our sins. They only cover impurities that are an imperfection. That's a good way to put it. An imperfection. We have many imperfections. And so these sacrifices are done in order to cover our imperfections. It covers the bodily imperfections, not the spiritual imperfection, but it covers our weakness, imperfection. It fills in the holes. That's what I would say is what it is. It helps us for that reason. It's an interesting topic. Thank you for asking the question. Hopefully what I said was helpful to you guys. We are at the 1 hour and about 25 minute mark. I'm hoping to go for maybe another 30 minutes if you guys want. Or if that's too long, I can go a little bit shorter than that. But I try to aim for the 2 hour mark. At the very least, 1 hour 30. But I try to aim for 2 hours. So if you want, you can ask more questions now. But let me see here. And from what I read for 1 Samuel earlier, I just showed you, like, just we only went through one chapter and then a little bit of the second chapter, and you already saw, like, major differences, you know? So it's like, wow, that's crazy. So now I'm not going to do all the same differences. I mean, I'm not going to do as many of the differences. I'm going to do the more important ones. So here's another one. This is I'm going to answer the next question that was asked, but so let me just go to this. Chapter 3, verse 21 of 1 Samuel. The Masoretic text says, King James translation, "And the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord." The Septuagint says, "And the Lord manifested..." Wait, excuse me, hold on. Yeah, okay. "And the Lord manifested himself again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord, and Samuel was accredited to all Israel as a prophet to the Lord from one end of the land to the other. And Eli was very old, and his sons kept heaping up, and their way was evil before the Lord." That whole thing, let me just slightly clarify. The King James actually says, "For the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord, and the word of Samuel came to all Israel." That's what it says. And as I said, the Septuagint says, "Samuel was accredited to all Israel as a prophet to the Lord from one end of the land to the other, and Eli was very old, and his sons kept heaping up, and their way was evil before the Lord." That's like, that's a huge difference. Like, it does not give any hint of that at all, those words, you know. So that's like a huge difference. But so let me see here. It wasn't a question, but yeah, it says, Lee was saying, "Adam covered his sin with a fig leaf, whereas God used the skin of an animal to do so." You know, it doesn't ever say specifically that an animal was killed for that purpose. So it's very possible that it was an animal that was killed, but it doesn't necessarily have to be, because there are some skins of animals that come off without the animal dying, like shedding a skin, things like that. But it could also be, there are other ideas of what the skin might be as well. But that is an interesting idea. Like, I've heard from people, you know, say how that was the first instance showing that sacrifices are needed to cover someone's imperfections. So interesting point that you brought up. Okay, so here's from chapter 4 of 1 Samuel, and I'm gonna do this one is, let's see here. Okay, it is verse 16 I'm going to read. Okay, so verse 16, this is crazy, look at this one. "And a man said unto Eli, I am he that came out of the army, and I fled today out of the army. And he said, What is there done, my son?" So that's the King James version from the Masoretic text. The Septuagint says, "And Eli said to them that stood round about him, What is the voice of this sound? And the man hasted and advanced to Eli and said to him, I am he that is come out of the camp, and I have fled from the battle today. And Eli said, What is the event, my son?" So basically, The Septuagint has an entire thing that Eli said, which is nowhere mentioned in the Masoretic. Eli, we're told in the Septuagint that Eli said to those that were around him, "What is the voice of this sound?" So that's a another major difference there. A whole extra sentence, you know. Let's see here. Chapter 5, verse 3 reads, in the King James Version, "And when they of Ashdod arose early on the morrow, behold, Dagon was fallen upon his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord. And they took Dagon and set him in his place again." The Septuagint says, in that same verse, "And the people of Ashdod rose early and entered into the house of Dagon and looked, and behold, Dagon had fallen on his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord. And they lifted up Dagon and set him in his place. And the hand of the Lord was heavy upon the Ashdodites, and he plagued them, and he smote them in their secret parts, Ashdod and her coasts." So you see right there that the extra words that we're told is, in the King James, we're just told, that they rose early and saw that Dagon had fallen on his face. Whereas in the Septuagint, we're told they entered into the house of Dagon and looked, and behold, he had fallen on his face. So there's that extra words. And then the Septuagint has a whole extra sentence, which is not in the other one, where it tells us that the hand of the Lord was heavy upon the Ashdodites. He plagued them, smote them in their secret parts, and Ashdod and all her and her coasts. So a whole sentence there. And then verse 4, at the end, we're told, verse 4, it says, "The head of Dagon," and this is the King James, "the head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands were cut off upon the threshold. Only the stump of Dagon was left to him." The Septuagint says, "The head of Dagon and both the palms of his hands were cut off, each before the threshold. And both the wrists of his hands had fallen on the floor of the porch. Only the stump of Dagon was left." So there's a whole extra clause of the wrists of his hands falling to the floor. And then another one in verse 6. It's the King James from the Hebrew text says, "But the hand of the Lord was heavy upon them of Ashdod, and he destroyed them and smote them with emerods, even Ashdod and the coast thereof." The Septuagint says, "And the hand of the Lord was heavy upon Ashdod, and he brought evil upon them, and it burst out upon them into the ships, and mice sprang up in the midst of their country, and there was a great and indiscriminate mortality in the city." A huge difference there. Let's see here. I'm just skipping all this stuff. There's so many other differences, but they're not as major as the ones that I just shared. So let me see. I'm skipping a lot of these. I'm just gonna, like, there's many more, but since, you know, as I said, we're getting more out of time, I'm just gonna go to the more important ones, okay? So I'm just skimming through right now to find the really interesting ones. Okay, so here's another one. This is chapter 10, So you see, I skipped a lot of chapters because I could have done many more, but they're not as major Chapter 10 of 1 Samuel, verse 1. King James says, from the Hebrew text, "Then Samuel took a vial of oil and poured it upon his head and kissed him and said, Is it not because the Lord hath anointed thee to be captain over his inheritance?" The Septuagint says, "And Samuel took a vial of oil and poured it on his head and kissed him and said to him, Has not the Lord anointed thee for a ruler over his people, over Israel? And thou shalt rule among the people of the Lord, and thou shalt save them out of the hand of their enemies. And this shall be the sign to thee that the Lord has anointed thee for a ruler over his inheritance." The King James Version basically just, from the Hebrew text, just says a question. It just says, hasn't the Lord anointed thee to be captain of his inheritance? Question mark. It leaves it open to, you know, that. But the Septuagint makes it clear. It says, has not the Lord anointed thee for a ruler over his people, over Israel? And thou shalt rule among the people of the Lord, and thou shalt save them out of the hand of their enemies. And this shall be the sign to thee that the Lord has anointed thee for a ruler over his inheritance. That's a huge difference. That changes the meaning of the passage significantly. See here. Let me just double check something. Okay. Okay, so here is a passage. This is at the beginning of chapter 11. It is clear that in our Bibles there's something missing. It doesn't make sense. All of a sudden it goes from one thing and jumps into another passage without context. In both the Septuagint and the Masoretic. But the Dead Sea Scrolls has an extra passage here, which is also confirmed by Josephus. Josephus confirms that this passage was in his copy. And so here's what... let's see. This is the first verse of the King James Version. It says... Chapter 11, 1 Samuel. Then Nahash the Ammonite came up and encamped against Jabesh Gilead. And all the men of Jabesh said unto Nahash, Make a covenant with us, and we will serve thee. That same verse in the Dead Sea Scrolls says, Nahash, king of the Ammonites, oppressed the Gadites and the Reubenites viciously. He put out the right eye of all of them and brought fear and trembling on Israel. Not one of the Israelites in the region beyond the Jordan remained whose right eye Nahash, king of the Ammonites, did not put out, except 7,000 men who escaped from the Ammonites and went to Jabesh Gilead. And it came to pass, about a month after this, that Nahash the Ammonite went up and encamped against Jabesh Gilead, and all the men of Jabesh said to Nahash the Ammonite, make a covenant with us, and we will serve thee. So you see, there's a whole introduction to the story that's not in our copies. Every single copy of the Bible does not have this passage. But the Dead Sea Scrolls proves it was in the original. So all Bibles are wrong by not having this passage. Yeah, the Dead Sea Scrolls has it. And since that time, some of the major English translations have included that extra passage from the scrolls as part of the Bible. The NIV, for instance, I'm pretty sure if I remember correctly, the NIV decided to incorporate it into their Bible copy. So right there, that's a huge difference. And then Here is chapter, excuse me, same chapter, chapter 11, verse 9. Verse 9 of the King James Version says, "And they said unto the messengers that came, Thus shall ye say unto the men of Jabesh-Gilead, Tomorrow by that time the sun be hot, ye shall have help. And the messengers came and showed it to the men of Jabesh, and they were glad." The Dead Sea Scroll copy, which was found, is much longer. And it says, "And he said to the messengers that came, Thus shall ye say to the men of Jabesh-Gilead, Tomorrow ye shall have the Lord's deliverance for Jabesh-Gilead granted unto you. They will divide the people into three companies and go into the midst of the camp in the morning watch and smite the children of Ammon until the sun is hot. And the messengers came to the city and told the men of Jabesh, and they rejoiced." So we see clear evidence of scribes shortening the text to condense the narrative, removing superfluous details that they felt was not needed. Let's see here. There are so many interesting differences, but I have to skip over most of them because of the time. But if you consult it on your own sometime, you'll see some really cool stuff. Okay, verse 21 of chapter 13. Verse 21 says, in the King James, "Yet they had a file for the mattocks, and for the coulters, and for the forks, and for the axes, and to sharpen the goads." See here. Hold on, let me just double check. So it says in the Septuagint, "And it was near the time of vintage, and their tools were 3 shekels for a plowshare, and there was the same rate for the axe and the sickle." That's not what the King James says. It doesn't mention the shekel for a plowshare. It doesn't say the time of vintage. So, like, that's huge difference. Okay, here's a good one. If you guys have some more questions, just let me know. But otherwise, I'll keep going through some of these interesting differences. Chapter 14. I'm going to read... the end of 22 and verse 23. So, okay. "Even they also," this is King James, "even they also followed hard after them in the battle. So the Lord saved Israel that day, and the battle passed over unto Beth-Aven." Here's what that same passage in the Septuagint says. "And the war passed through Bamoth, and all the people with Saul were about 10,000 men. And the battle extended itself to every city in the Mount Ephraim." That's all it says. I mean, that's what it says. That's That's very different from what the King James says of the battle passed over unto Beth Aven. And then, wait, hold on 1 second. So then, it says in the King James, and the men of Israel were distressed that day, for Saul had adjured the people, saying, cursed be the man that eateth any food until evening. It says in the Septuagint, and Saul committed a great trespass of ignorance in that day, and he lays a curse on the people, saying, cursed is the man who shall eat bread before the evening. So, in the Septuagint, we're told that he did a great trespass of ignorance. We're not told that in the King James. And then here is a huge difference. Verses 41 in the same chapter, 41 to 42. King James. Therefore Saul said unto the Lord God of Israel, give a perfect lot. And Saul and Jonathan were taken, but the people escaped. And Saul said, cast lots between me and Jonathan my son. And Jonathan was taken. You can see how that's very, like, it seems like too quick. It goes through it very quickly. The Septuagint says, those same two verses, it says, and Saul said, O Lord God of Israel, why hast thou not answered thy servant this day? Is the iniquity in me, or in Jonathan my son? Lord God of Israel, give clarity, and if the lot should declare this, give, I pray thee, to thy people of Israel, give, I pray, holiness. And Jonathan and Saul are taken, and the people escaped. And Saul said, cast lots between me and my son Jonathan. Whomsoever the Lord shall cause to be taken by lot, let him die. And the people said to Saul, this thing is not to be done. And Saul prevailed against the people. And they cast lots between him and Jonathan his son. And Jonathan is taken by lot. Do you see the huge differences there? I'll just read the King James version of that one more time. The same thing, King James version of that is, therefore Saul said unto the Lord God of Israel, give a perfect lot. And Saul and Jonathan were taken, but the people escaped. And Saul said, cast lots between me and Jonathan my son. And Jonathan was taken. So either the Septuagint, whoever made the Septuagint, either they were like adding things all over the place, you know, being crazy with the scripture, adding a bunch of details without justification, or the original had those full details, and then scribes decided to just to remove the details because they thought, oh, that's unnecessary. We'll just shorten it, the narrative, because we're preserving the basic same essence of the story. Because think about it. What Jews in their right mind, what Israelites in their right mind would add things that they have no basis to add like that, like so badly like that? It doesn't make sense. But it makes more sense for someone to remove things that are that they feel are unnecessary details, and that you can preserve the story essence with less of those details. So the Dead Sea Scrolls, you know, has so much more of these extra details, just as the Septuagint does. The evidence best supports that these details are authentic, and part of the original text. And in that case, what we see in our copies of the Bible is a major condensed version of the full original text, which is very sad and very discouraging to see that they did this. But that's what the evidence is pointing us to. There's so many examples of them doing this. So here's an example of chapter 15. Verse 3 says, in the King James, now go and smite Amalek, and utterly destroy all of that they have, and spare them not, but slay both man and woman, infant and suckling, ox and sheep, camel and donkey, or camel and ass. And the Septuagint says, And now go, and thou shalt smite Amalek and all that belongs to him. And thou shalt not save anything of him alive, but thou shalt utterly destroy him. And thou shalt devote him and all his to destruction. And thou shalt not spare nothing belonging to him. And thou shalt slay both man and woman, and infant and suckling, and calf and sheep, and camel and donkey. So basically, there's a whole extra thing about, like it says in the Septuagint, thou shalt not save anything of him alive, thou shalt utterly destroy him, and thou shalt devote him and all his to destruction. The King James Version simply says, utterly destroy it. Basically, it condenses it to utterly destroy them. It's clearly that the King James Version, the Masoretic text, is condensing these huge, long passages to little pithy things, little details like that. Here's verse 12 of that chapter. King James. And when Samuel rose early to meet Saul in the morning, it was told Samuel, saying, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set him up a place, and is gone about, and passed on, and gone down to Gilgal. The Septuagint says, And Samuel rose early, and went to meet Israel in the morning. And it was told Saul, saying, Samuel has come to Carmel, and he has raised up help for himself. And he turned his chariot, and came down to Gilgal to Saul, and behold, he was offering up a whole burnt offering to the Lord, the chief of the spoils, which he brought out of Amalek. That's a huge it's extra details, which we already knew by the context of the passage. We already knew that about the context of the passage, but the extra details not in the King James Version. So, you know, the King James simply says, gone down to Gilgal. But the Septuagint says, came down to Gilgal to Saul, and behold, he was offering up a whole burnt offering to the Lord, the chief of the spoils which he brought out of Amalek. All of that's not in our text, but it's in the Septuagint. It's stuff like that which gets me really upset with what they did with the scriptures. But you think, well, maybe it's just 1 Samuel. Maybe all the other books were well preserved and this didn't happen. Unfortunately, that's not the case. The same exact thing happens in so many of the other books. Some of the books didn't happen as bad. Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 and 2 Chronicles, Ecclesiastes. Those were the ones which were not as badly corrupted. They were still altered some, but not as bad as this. There were other books which were really badly altered, just like this. But the ones I just mentioned, Joshua, Judges, you know, all the ones I just mentioned, those were relatively speaking, well-preserved. In all copies, they're mostly the same. So not all of them, but a good chunk of the Old Testament is horribly altered from the original version. So yeah, it's very depressing of this. See here. How much time here? Okay, chapter 17, verse 36. Oh, wait, just so you know, the Septuagint, for some reason, scholars are not sure about why this is, but the Septuagint from chapter 17 and on, it's like 20, chapter 20, the Septuagint is missing huge chunks of the story. Huge chunks. Let me quickly look here. Chapter 17, verses 12 all the way to verse 31 is in the Masoretic version, but is missing in the Septuagint. It's completely missing. And then there's other verses too, which are missing in the Septuagint version, but not in the Masoretic text. So there's two possibilities here, is that these stories were added from another book of scripture, like an Apocrypha book, they were added from it, or the Septuagint for some reason removed it, possibly because they didn't like some of what was said in it. because there are certain things in it which are controversial, or things which seem to contradict other parts of the book or the Bible. So, so that's a major difference between the two. But verse 36 is in both versions, and it says in the King James Version, it says, "Thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them, seeing he hath defied the armies of the living God." That's in the King James. The Septuagint says, "Thy servant smote both the lion and the bear, and the uncircumcised Philistine shall be as one of them. Shall I not go and smite him, and remove this day a reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised one who has defied the army of the living God?" So there's a whole extra clause in another sentence in the Septuagint one. And then here's an interesting one that I really like. Verse 43 of that chapter, King James says, "And the Philistine said unto David, Am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods." The Septuagint says, "And the Philistine said to David, Am I a dog that thou comest against me with a staff and stones? And David said, Nay, but worse than a dog. And the Philistine cursed David by his gods." So, you know, it's like, there's things like that which are really interesting. One of the passages that the Septuagint removes, which the Masoretic text has, is, you can see why the Septuagint probably removed this. It says, "And Saul eyed David from that day and forward. And it came to pass on the morrow that the evil spirit from God came upon Saul, and he prophesied in the midst of the house, and David played with his hand as at other times, and there was a javelin in Saul's hand. And Saul cast the javelin, for he said, I will smite David even to the wall with it. And David left out of his presence twice." That passage is not in the King James. What it seems like is that whoever made the Septuagint version did not like the idea that there's an evil spirit from God that was given to Saul. And Saul was trying to kill David. Like, Saul was so murdering, hateful. So it seems like the passage was removed because of that reason. That it was not portraying Saul in a way that the writer thought was correct. And it was portraying God as sending evil spirits and evil spirits prophesying. It sounds like Gnosticism almost. Like, God being an evil deity, that's what the Gnostics believed, and the Gnostics also said that, he had prophets, but the prophets prophesied by the evil God, by the power of the evil God. The creator was evil, they said. That's what it kind of sounds like. It says the evil spirit from God came into Saul, and he prophesied. So God is giving Saul, he's making Saul a prophet through an evil spirit. That seems really strange. That's probably why the Septuagint removed that passage. And that's how I interpret it, why it's missing. But obviously, you know, God is not evil. And when it says the evil spirit was sent into Saul from God, and that he prophesied, we know that the demons have the ability to prophesy. And we know that the demons, according to scripture, Jubilees tells us, and there's many other books, basically tells us that the demons actually are serving and obeying God. And how are they doing that? They're told, anyone who is sinful and defiles himself and hands himself over to evil, you have the right and I'm giving you the authority to possess them and to do what you will with them, within a certain limitation. So because Saul was doing evil, God sent the demons to Saul to punish him. The scriptures say that God chose the demons to be the agents of punishment. He wanted to redeem demons because, you know, the demons exist. So he said, how can I put them to good use? And so he uses them for a good purpose. Just like how Joseph was sold into slavery. Well, that's a sin. You know, that was a horrible thing that happened. His brothers betrayed him. And yet he used that to save the world. And so God sent Joseph to Egypt, specifically to save the world, but he used it through agents of evil. The agents of evil caused Joseph to be there, but God was ultimately orchestrating that for the purpose, the greater purpose of Joseph bringing about righteousness. So that's the explanation of that. Let's see how we're at the 2-hour mark. So I'm pretty much about to end it, but let me just look at a couple more things of the. Let me see if there's any last really cool passage to read. Let's see, I'm just skimming through. I have my version. I marked the differences so that I could go through it quicker. So let's see here. Let me see. This one was kind of funny. Let me see it. See here. This is chapter 21. Let me just quickly check it. Yeah, so here's an interesting one. 21 verse 13, this is when David is being crazy, pretending to be crazy. It says, and he changed his behavior before them and feigned himself mad in their hands and scrabbled on the doors of the gate and let his spittle fall down upon his beard. The Septuagint says, and he changed his appearance before him and feigned himself in that day and drummed upon the doors of the city and used extravagant gestures with his hands and fell upon the doors of the gate and his spittle ran down his beard. So that's just given much more, you know, much more detail about what David was doing. But it's preserving the same basic storyline plot. Let's okay, chapter 29, verse 10. That is... Okay, King James says, wherefore now rise up early in the morning with thy master's servants that are come with thee, and as soon as you be up early in the morning and have light, depart. Septuagint says, now, wait, let's see, yeah, now then rise up early in the morning, thou and the servants of thy Lord that are come with thee, and go to the place where I appointed you, and entertain no evil thought in thy heart, for thou art good in my sight, and rise early for your journey, for it is light, and depart. So, you know, there's that whole extra thing where the Septuagint says, go to the place I appointed you, entertain no evil thought in your heart, for you are good in my sight. None of that's in the King James Version. None of that's in the Hebrew text, but it's in the Septuagint. So it's things like that. So many of these extra details. It's like, wow, there's some major differences. So I think that's about it. there is one thing, at least just one thing that I want to read from 2 Samuel, which is like, wow, they changed that? It shows you, like, the thought process through what the scribes are doing. Okay? I'm just finding it. Hold on 1 second. Sorry, I'll just take a little bit to find it, but it won't take too long. Okay, I found it. So David, here's what happened in the story: is Tamar was raped by her brother, by Amnon. Okay, Absalom, the other brother, was very pissed off and angry at. He hated the brother that raped her with all his heart. He wanted him to die and for him to be killed. And ultimately, Absalom ended up killing him because of so much hate he had for him for doing that to his sister. Because seriously, rape is pretty horrible. Here is what... this is 2 Samuel 13. 2 Samuel 13, verse 21. And you're going to see, this is what they're doing. This is what the scribes are doing. The King James, the Hebrew text says, "But when King David heard of all these things, he was very wroth." You know, very angry. Okay, that's all it says. The Septuagint says, "And King David heard all of these things and was very angry, but he did not grieve the spirit of his son Amnon, because he loved him, for he was his firstborn." You see that? It seems to be the case that the maker of the Masoretic text, they saw this and they're like, this is not making David look good. It's basically saying that David was having a bad judgment because he was his firstborn son. So they removed that. But the Septuagint preserves for us the truth about David. It tells us that he did not grieve the spirit of his son Amnon because he loved him, for he was his firstborn. So, you know, so that's what we're seeing. We're seeing, wow, the scribes, when they don't like something, the implications of something, they're going to remove it. That's what the scribes did, and they did it so many times. It's really upsetting, but they did it with almost every book in the Bible. So, there's so many other cool things to show you. I'll have to go through it in other times, because we're out of time this time. But I hope that what I have shared with you this time is very amazing to you guys, that opens your eyes to what the scribes have done. And I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you all for coming. And I'm gonna reschedule this, not to be Wednesdays anymore. I think I'm gonna move it to Sundays. So hope you guys will be able to attend on Sundays. And thank you all for coming. Shalom.